Hi, I'm State Senator George Latimer. Welcome to Legislative Report. Our conversation today is with an author, Doug Gladstone, who is a resident of the Capital District. And the story that we're going to talk about for the next 15 minutes ties in both Mount Rushmore in South Dakota and Port Chester, New York. Doug, thanks for being with us today.
Senator, it's a pleasure. Thank you for affording me the opportunity to come on in.
My pleasure as well. The most recent book that you authored involved one of my great passions, which is baseball. But today we're here to talk about Mount Rushmore and the process that went into the creation of that amazing American site and what its involvement is for a person who has roots in Port Chester, Luigi Del Bianco. Tell us a little bit about the book and what the basic storyline is that you're telling.
No problem. Again, thank you for the opportunity. As you correctly said, one of your constituents, Lou Del Bianco, is the grandson of the chief carver of the monument of Mount Rushmore, Luigi Del Bianco, an Italian-American immigrant to these shores, studied with no less an acclaimed sculptor than Gutzon Borglum, the head designer and sculptor of Mount Rushmore. And Luigi, went to his grave in 1969, regrettably, not getting the credit that he deserves, not getting the props or the kudos or the accolades for bringing those faces to life. He was literally hired to, as all the papers of Gutzon Borglum attest, create the refinement of expression. So when you look at Lincoln's eyes, Luigi Del Bianco was the one who gave those eyes its soul. I know that sounds very melodramatic and histrionical, but someone had to bring those busts to life, and Mr. Del Bianco did indeed do that. The problem with him not receiving the credit that I and others feel he's deserving of is the United States Department of the Interior's National Park Service has an antiquated policy of only recognizing two people at that monument, Gutzon Borglum and his late son, Lincoln Borglum. For example, I have a lot of friends in the scaffolding industry, but scaffolding was needed, obviously, for the men to go up on that mountain and work. One of the gentlemen who I spoke for, one of the only two living individuals still alive who worked at that monument, literally had to cut the bark of what is referred to as lodgepole pine. It helped eliminate the lodgepole pine population, but more importantly, it was necessary for the men to actually have scaffolding to work at the monument. That gentleman in the history books receives the same type of credit that Luigi Del Bianco did. Let's say, for example, that you or one of your staff members operated the elevator lift to the monument. You would receive the same credit as Luigi Del Bianco, who I kind of believe had a little bit more important job than someone who cut tree bark or someone who ran an elevator lift. That's my book's central point, that the National Park Service is doing this man, the late Luigi Del Bianco, an incredible injustice. It's a great immigrant story. Mm-hmm. Immigrants obviously have made a lot of contributions to this great country, and it's an antiquated policy, yet the National Park Service continues to flout this policy in the face of Mr. Del Bianco's grandson, Lou Del Bianco.
Well, and I came to this story through Lou Del Bianco, the grandson, who I know as a friend in Port Chester. And he's been very active in the arts, along with his wife, Camille Lennon. They've been sort of the leaders of the Port Chester Council for the Arts, and they've done a variety of different things. And Lou, the grandson, our contemporary, has actually done some programs where he channels his grandfather, acts out the story of his life, which is fascinating. And it's fascinating to me personally, although the last name may not reflect it, I'm half Italian-American. And my great-grandfather, when he came from Italy in the 1880s, as I am told, I don't have all the documents to prove it, was a stonemason, and not necessarily a refined talent, but one of many of the Italian immigrants who came from Italy to Westchester County to work on the Kensico Dam and other stonework around. So the fact that a person had honed their skills to the level of being able to do the kind of work that helped to create Mount Rushmore was really phenomenal. And obviously, you know, we think ought to be recognized. How did you come by this story?
I have harbored a love for the monument ever since I was a little boy. that love was actually perpetuated by the famous Hitchcock movie, North by Northwest, in which Cary Grant and Eva Marie Saint are chasing or trying to get out of the way of enemy spies. I found the story of, you mentioned at the outset, you alluded to my first book, A Bitter Cup of Coffee, which tells the story of retired baseball players who did not receive pensions or health insurance for Major League Baseball. Simply to follow up on the story of individuals who have been, in my opinion, hosed or taken advantage of, I was looking for one individual, not necessarily with Mount Rushmore, but I came across the story of Luigi from Lou's very, very phenomenal website, LuigiMountRushmore.com, www.LuigiMountRushmore.com. And the more and more I read about this gentleman, the more and more the light bulb went off in my head saying, this guy has been taken advantage of. He needs an advocate, and nobody's defending him. Now, you will recall that when you worked for Representative Nita Lowey, you tried to be an advocate for the late Mr. Del Bianco. I believe you drafted a letter for Representative Lowey. It was sent to the congressional liaison to the Park Service, and soon after that, Michael Reynolds, the Midwestern Regional Director for the National Park Service, got in touch with Lou. Mr. Reynolds does not return Lou's phone calls now. Essentially, Mr. Reynolds has taken the tact, the position, the stance that, look, there is no I in team. And no matter how Mr. Del Bianco and his family want to extol the contributions of his late grandfather, the person who we, meaning the federal government, acknowledge as being the big kahuna at that monument was Gutzon Borglum.
Doug, as you've done your research on this, and no one takes credit away from those who have been credited already, do you sense any prejudicial behavior in here, anything that looks at the immigrant involvement in something like this and perhaps does not give it its proper weight because of that?
Luigi Del Bianco, Senator, was a very private man, and we don't have any firsthand proof. We don't have any of his oral recollections to draw from. But there's a very famous letter that Gutzon Borglum wrote in July of 1930, in which he alludes to bringing this great marble stone artisan from Portchester to the monument and was told by the folks in Keystone, South Dakota, where the monument is based, that he was not wanted. Now, we can ponder and we can wonder why he was not wanted, but could it have been because of bias? Could it have been because of prejudice? Absolutely.
The nature of, just in general now, this is more the author's and the researcher's talent, how do you go about trying to reconstruct a story that's 80 years old without the primary individuals alive to talk to?
The National the National Archives and the Library of Congress house approximately 170 boxes of Gutzon Borglum's private correspondence and paperwork. About 100 of them are solely geared to Mount Rushmore. That's one way. The other way is to try and ferret out the stories of, as I said, there were two individuals who worked at the monument who were still alive, and I spoke to both those gentlemen in the research of my book. And you try and get information from the, for example, the State Historical Society, mm-hmm. who've been very helpful. South Dakota has only an Italian American population of 1% of the people living there. And I know the one of the individuals who I spoke to, who I guess would be analogous to our state attorney general, mm-hmm. he's the prosecutor for one of the counties in South Dakota. He's an Italian American. He had no clue about this, mm-hmm. no clue. And because of me reaching him, I've been put in touch with people in South Dakota who similarly had no idea that an Italian American immigrant to these shores was the chief carver of Mount Rushmore. And I think that's really tragic because the National Park Service has been a great proponent of multiculturalism.
Right.
They have had, for example, Norwegian Day at the monument, Czech Day at the monument. Norwegians and Czechoslovakians apparently comprise the greatest immigrant population in that state. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm giving you I'm literally feeding you a softball that your chief carver was an Italian American, and you don't trumpet that fact? Something's not right.
Yeah. Well, what's amazing to me also is that we're dealing with a project, Mount Rushmore, that by every standard is a success. It is an iconic American figure as at the level of Statue of Liberty, the Gateway Arch in St. Louis. You see it, you know exactly what it is. And generally speaking, victory has 1,000 fathers. So there's enough credit to go around that it doesn't diminish the role of any one individual to have any other individual credited for what they actually did do. And, to look at the monument from the ground level and look up at it, you just to imagine anybody, tethered off the edge of this in order to get the finer points of Jefferson's nose or Lincoln's eyes, mm-hmm. it's an incredible individual task. So obviously I hope there's a certain amount of pressure that can be placed on the Department of the Interior to have them reconsider, how they view Luigi Del Bianco. Do you have a sense that under the right set of circumstances, the Department of Interior, or more specifically, the people responsible for this park, can change their point of view? Or do you think it's bureaucracy locked in as it stands now?
I think it is definitely bureaucracy locked in. But, I would suspect that that exerting the amount of pressure is the way bureaucracy changes. No less than Thomas Jefferson, one of the people who has paid tribute on that monument, used to say, bad government is government that is not helping. Well, that is sort of my opinion. It doesn't take anything to recognize Luigi Del Bianco. No one for the moment, as he suggests, is trying to detract away or take away credit from Gutzon Borglum and to a lesser extent his son Lincoln. We're just trying to acknowledge that the chief carver was an Italian-American immigrant. You want to put a stone there at the base of the monument? Fine. But don't tell me that Luigi Del Bianco's contributions was the same or similar to as a man who cut pine bark or who operated the elevator lift.
We've got less than a minute left. I assume your book will go a long way toward redressing the balance. When does it come out in print where people can buy it?
The book is coming out in May of 2014. The book's title is called Carving a Niche for Himself, The Untold Story of Luigi Del Bianco and Mount Rushmore. And I do, in fact, hope that it does have some type of an impact. That's why journalists write, to have an impact on society.
Well, when you do your book tour, there'll certainly be a stop somewhere in Westchester County. We'll be happy to be with you at that moment and for some of the other moments that are coming up.
Look forward to it.
We've been speaking with Doug Gladstone, who is the author of a book about the experience of Luigi Del Bianco, the chief carver of the Mount Rushmore historic site in South Dakota, and his grandson, Lou Del Bianco, from Portchester, New York, right in our home Heath. This is State Senator George Latimer. Thanks for tuning in. We look forward to seeing you the next time. Have a great day. Thank you.